Welcome everyone to this episode of Freedom Hub's Working Group. I'm your host, Jeff Cantor, along with my co-host, Charles Frohman. We are most absolutely sponsored by the Marketplace for Health, Wealth, and Freedom. Here's our little acronym here, which is a part of Freedom Hub, which is, of course, is where all the disruptors of the world tend to try to intersect here and see what we can do to make something a little bit better. We are recording all of these, and we have a variety of platforms that we're on, but we'll take a detour into those here momentarily. We also have another series that we run on Thursday nights to be aware of. I'm sorry, Wednesday nights also, which is later today, and that's with the cash patient one, also very interesting, and you'll want to take a look at that similarly. And again, you'll want to visit the website. There's two addresses, takes you to the same place. And let's take a quick look, see what's going on over there. So if you come to the site, there's an awful lot here to see. There's a lot of great stuff under these drop downs that you'll want to come back to. Under the home one, you'll see the webinars, and that's what we're on today. But before we go there for a minute, we do feature continuing the conversation. So just like today, most of these topics, it's interesting enough that you need to pursue it on an ongoing basis. So we have a place for you to be able to connect with the speakers of the past and get tied to their blog or help get involved in their issues and mission, as it were, and there's plenty of things that you want to do, and sadly there's a lot that needs to be worked on. And then also under the Freedom tab, Fighting for Freedom, this is an important area too. Here's where we're featuring all of the key issues and action items, and we try to rotate these in and out of here as they become stale, but these are all vital. Sadly, it's not like you just pick one or the other. You really need to deal with all of them. And then we have an ever-growing list of organizations that are helping try to keep freedom in the forefront in American space. So if we come back though, like I said, to the webinars tab, let's shift over to where we are today a little bit to show you how that page works. There's a little info about it, a breakdown on the two key speakers of the current week, a little breakout on the ones coming up. And then also here, most importantly, are the links to be able to see the past shows. So as an example here, we're on BitChute, Brighteon, YouTube, and Rumble. So as an example, if we clicked on the Brighteon one, it opened up the archive, and as you'll see, there's a wealth of people that have been on here, and there's some really, really great topics. And as I said, you know, it doesn't matter if you pick one that's a month old or a year old, some of this stuff is sadly still important as all get out, so you'll definitely want to take a look-see. But let's go back and take a look at today's agenda. So let me zoom back up here a little bit, come back here. So here we are at the Wednesday, 4 o'clock Eastern. And we've got Brian Riley with us here today, and I'm going to let Charles do the honor.
Thank you, Jeff, and welcome, Brian. This is not an easy topic because I think people, when they look into trade, if they go towards a libertarian direction, they get the logic of, you know, supporting voluntary exchange. But then when you look at politics, you see nothing is pure, everything is a compromise, and there's so much special interest exploitation. You have to look at it a little bit more deeply to figure out how to, you know, like or dislike what a president or a Congress is doing with trade. You know, back in the early 90s, when I was a Republican staffer for Congressman Geekus, I remember just, you know, supporting NAFTA with Bill Clinton, a bipartisan thing to get some trade going in North America. It seemed good. And I remember getting, you know, harassed by some union folks in Harrisburg, the capital, when I said most letters were supportive of it. Honestly, I'm not sure I was correct in that statement I made. I don't know. I don't remember if most letters from constituents supported NAFTA or not. But I know these blue-collar industrial workers and union reps were very hostile to it. And when I got more libertarian working in DC and, you know, following Ron Paul, I liked his argument about wanting free trade, but without the managed trade bureaucracy around it. And then in the 2000s, when I was lobbying for various small nonprofits after I had been at Cato, one natural health client was really up in arms with the enforcement arm of these agreements at the World Trade Organization. In the capacity of that client, this international food trade regulator called Codex was dominated by big agra and big pharma, And they were really trying to force what's called harmonization by the FDAs of the world to accept, dumbed down nutrient standards and allow, more toxic residue existence in foods and milk and et cetera. So I really got to see the free trade kind of corrupted by the special interest, as it happens with most bureaucracies in most markets. And then along came Trump, who really went full bore protectionist and got a lot of support for that across the country. And right before then, for Governor Gary Johnson's nonprofit, Our America Initiative, I was recruiting all these thought leaders for these different advisory councils. And I believe Brian was at Heritage when he accepted a position on, I think, the Economic Advisory Council, or maybe it was Immigration and Trade. I can't recall which. This is a half dozen years ago. And now at National Taxpayers Union, Brian is making some strong statements about free trade and its future. We don't know quite what Biden is going to do with the agreements and international trade, but we do know that trade is important. You know, you could either trade or fight, which is kind of simplistic. So let's hear Brian kind of explain it for us, Jeff.
Well, very good. Very good. Brian, please take it away. I'm going to give you the screen sharing capabilities there.
Okay. Well, good deal. Thank you both for having me on. You've had some great guests in the past, and it's appreciate the chance to be added to that list. And Charles, what an excellent introduction to trade policy and what's been going on, not just over the last few years, but the last few decades. I wanted to start by just saying a little bit about the organization I work for, National Taxpayers Union. For people who may not be familiar with it, we're the country's oldest taxpayer organization. We've been around over 50 years. As you know, Charles and your listeners, I'm sure other viewers, there's a lobbying group and an association for everything you can think of in DC, from catfish farmers to unions to college professors, you name it. And we were founded a little over 50 years ago to represent the interests of taxpayers. And so it's been a great place for me to work. It's a great organization and good people here. And sometimes people will say, well, wait, you're talking about trade policy, but you're at the Taxpayers Union. What's the connection there? Tariffs are just taxes. They are taxes on imports. And when President Trump took office, there was a view at NTU that the biggest risk, there were a lot of potential opportunities with respect to taxes, but the biggest risk was that we would have tax increases on imports, the protectionism that was mentioned in the introduction. So I've worked on trade policy for a long time. The biggest and the most interesting change for me personally was that before President Trump's campaign, trade typically was a pretty low profile issue. If you ask people what's most important to you, it would be the economy or education or healthcare, and trade would just be an asterisk at the bottom for most people. But we got President Trump, and people are talking about trade, making jokes about it on Saturday Night Live and front page of newspapers. So it's been an exciting time to work on trade policy.
Go, now it's coming. Perfect.
Yeah. So I talked about all the different interest groups around the country. One of the things that I don't know if you guys remember the movie Office Space, where the scam that the employees come up with is they're just going to take a few cents out of everybody's account and put it in their own pockets, and they're just going to take a few cents, so nobody's going to notice, and they will get rich. And to me, this is a good explanation of what happens in DC, where somebody will come, you just fill in the blank of whatever group it might be. Farmers, we need soybean subsidies, and it's going to benefit us, and If you're a senator who represents a bunch of soybean farmers, you try and give them that benefit, and the costs are spread out across the country and maybe not noticed so much. I think that's a real challenge going forward for economic policy in the United States. The same thing happened with trade policy. Early on, the Trump administration put tariffs on imported steel and aluminum. And that's our Secretary of Commerce, Wilbur Ross. And he said, look, this is these tariffs of 10% on aluminum, 25% on steel, but they're only going to add a penny to a six pack of beer, you know, a fraction to a can of soup. Nobody's going to notice the difference. To some extent, I'd have to say he was right. You don't notice the difference when you buy a can of soup for these tariffs. But people buy a lot of cans of soup, a lot of cans of Coke, a lot of cans of beer, and it adds up and imposes real costs on the country. So that's one of the challenges facing us on trade policy. Trade is something that just a real quick history. If you think of the Declaration of Independence, most people remember we were angry at the king for making us quarter troops, for imposing taxes on us without our consent. But it also references the King of England cutting off our trade with all parts of the world as part of the reason that we fought for our independence from England. And then in the Constitution, one of the key components of one of the many key components of the Constitution, in my opinion, was the Commerce Clause, which said if you're living in Iowa, your legislature can't tax products coming from Arizona. Of course, at the time, it would have been, I guess, Virginia and maybe New York, not those two states. So in effect, what the Constitution did was create a free trade zone among the states that really allowed the country to prosper. In looking at trade policy, a couple of things that I always remind myself of and remind others of. When I'm talking to a congressional staffer, it's very similar to the description Charles provided in the introduction. A lot of the requests they hear are from specific sectors, businesses looking for protection from competition. I should say unfair competition, because any competition seems to be unfair competition. And the people who typically will call me at NTU or will call a congressional office are the people who are mad about trade and think we're getting taken advantage of and ripped off and we need to do something about it, kind of the squeaky wheel. But if you look at public opinion polls, and there's one right in front of you, but there's many from Gallup and Reuters and the NBC News and others, support for trade is really pretty high among the public. One of the reasons I like working on trade policy, my background's in economics, and it's a pretty straightforward issue from the economic side of things. But generally speaking, you talk to Republican voters, you talk to libertarians, you talk to Democratic voters, and there's generally going to be support for trade. Those numbers are a little bit thrown off by President Trump, because you had a lot of people on both sides responding, answering the question, maybe not so much based on what they think of trade, but what they think of the president. But support for trade is strong and has been growing. And one of the things that frustrates me, and one of my pet peeves, is when I hear people talk about populist trade policies. And by populist, they refer to a need for more protection and more nationalism. And I understand the definition of populism, why that is, but I think of populist as popular. And if you decide to go in and say, we're gonna impose a bunch of tariffs on everything, you're really representing a small minority, maybe a vocal minority, but a small minority of voters across the United States. This view is almost universally accepted among economists. Now, we can debate and maybe have a chance to discuss later on whether we should have trade agreements, whether we should do things unilaterally, or the best ways to move forward. But if you ask economists, they're almost always going to say free trade is good, protectionism is bad. Going all the way back to Adam Smith in 1776 and David Ricardo, the idea that if somebody in Brazil has a comparative advantage of growing bananas, we're better off buying the bananas from Brazil than trying to grow them in Minnesota or someplace else. So we're better doing the things that we have an advantage in and trading for those goods. And that's, to me, really what free trade is all about. Just to define it, because phrases mean different things to different people. If Charles, if you come see me in DC and I like your t-shirts and say, I'd like to buy it from you. And you say, well, I'll sell it to you for $20. And I say, well, I'll give you $15. And we wind up saying $17.50, I buy your t-shirt. That's not a situation where one person has won and one person has lost. It's free trade. I voluntarily wanted to purchase it. Somebody voluntarily wanted to sell it. It's win-win. It's a mutually beneficial transaction. It's a reciprocal trade. It's free. It's fair. There's no government agency or bureaucrat or a law that says, no, you can't do that. So that's essentially what I view free trade to be. And it doesn't matter whether it's me and a friend of mine having lunch and be buying it from them, or an international trade, whether I'm buying something from Mexico or Canada or Europe or even China, for that matter. One of the benefits of our trade policies, and I include NAFTA and the World Trade Organization generally as part of the reason for this trend to lower tariffs. Lower tariffs in the United States, definitely, which I think is a good thing, but also lower tariffs worldwide. And if you look since about 1993 or so, and by the way, NAFTA took effect in 94 and the World Trade Organization in 95, and China joined the World Trade Organization in about roughly 2002, the average world tariffs have come down as a result of in part our trade negotiations, giving us more export markets. Those average world tariffs have also come down in part because countries largely recognize that if they wanted to attract more investment to their countries, if they wanted to be more prosperous, it was in their own self-interest to cut tariffs as well. I'm going to blow through a few charts, basically talking about how I respond to some of the people who are saying we've been getting ripped off, we're getting taken advantage of by all these other countries. But if you look at the time frame that I described starting in about 1993, 1994, the income for poorest Americans has increased. Median or average, depending on how you choose to measure it, earnings, even after adjusting for inflation, have increased in the United States. One of the big criticisms of trade that I hear over and over again in DC is that we have fewer manufacturing workers than we used to in the past. And there's a grain of truth to that. If you look at the trend of manufacturing employment from World War II to 2000, manufacturing employment as a share of total employment was going down. But if you look at how much we produce, other than interruptions from recessions and economic problems, our output was going up. So we were producing more with fewer workers. And I think whether you're in agriculture or manufacturing or anything else, making more with fewer workers is a positive thing. That's a trend, by the way, that after the last recession, the reduction in manufacturing jobs reversed and we wound up having increases in manufacturing employment. So when somebody says, oh, we've lost all these manufacturing jobs, they might be talking about an issue that no longer existed as of 2010, where we began increasing not just manufacturing output, but also employment. Now, obviously in the current environment, this stops before 2020 and the numbers are gonna be a lot different. And so it'd be a real challenge trying to bring those back up going forward. While we lost manufacturing jobs, let me try and make clear what this chart shows. This is manufacturing layoffs. And it starts in December 2001, roughly when China joined the World Trade Organization. And while we lost manufacturing jobs, the rate of manufacturing layoffs was declining as well. Well, fewer people are getting laid off and fired from manufacturing, but we also have fewer manufacturing jobs. What's the explanation? And the most logical explanation is workers are finding better opportunities someplace else. There are a lot of good manufacturing jobs, but if you look back to the 70s and 80s, a lot of the jobs that were phased out were jobs, say, sitting in front of a sewing machine, sewing together shoes 40 hours a week for minimum wage. Are those the kinds of jobs that we want to try and return to, or do we want to try and encourage more high-tech jobs, more value-added that pay more? And I certainly lean towards the latter. And by the way, when I was talking about the view of economists on trade policy, NTU at the start of the Trump administration released a letter from about 1,200 economists, including several Nobel laureates, calling on President Trump not to impose protectionist tariffs. And when we were drafting the letter, like, well, how should we say this in a way that really encompasses all the important issues that economists will want to sign on to? And we wound up literally copying a letter from 1930 that economists sent to Congress before the Smoot-Hawley Tariff Act was imposed. And they said, tariffs would be bad. They would increase costs for farmers. They would increase input prices. They would raise prices for consumers. And they also pointed out that when we impose tariffs on foreign trading partners, they retaliate and turn around and impose tariffs on us. And that can actually escalate from trade wars and become and lead to real hostility between countries. So after World War II, the U.S. tried to reduce trade barriers, not just for our economic benefit, but to promote peaceful relations, free commerce, commercial relations between individuals and between countries. That job growth in recent years that I talked about, a big chunk of it came from foreign investment in the United States. And about 4 years ago, I was driving from Florida back to the DC area. And you drive a few hours north from the panhandle and you see there's a big Hyundai factory. And then you drive a few more hours and you see a big Kia factory. You drive these in Alabama and Georgia. You drive up to South Carolina and you see, I think at the time, the world's largest BMW factory in South Carolina. We get back to DC and I was like, oh, we don't make anything anymore. It's terrible. What are you talking about? You look out the window and you look at the numbers, we're making more than we ever have, again, until the pandemic. And a big reason for that is, if we have good economic policies here, good tax policies, good regulatory policies, if we make America the best place in the world to do business, we're going to see foreign investors want to do business here and create jobs here. The other thing that I think is important about the investment side of things is when we import a good from another country as Americans, we buy 1,000 cars from Japan and they use that money to buy wheat and corn and soybeans and cattle from the Midwest. In equal amounts, we have a trade balance. And everybody says trade balance is, I shouldn't say everybody, but the mercantilist view is a trade balance is good or exports are good, but imports are bad. What if some of those Japanese car makers, after we buy their cars, if they use those dollars instead of buying U.S. exports to decide to invest in our economy, whether it's to buy U.S. Treasury bonds, to invest in our stock market, or to go to Alabama and build a new Mazda factory, those don't count as exports. So our trade statistics will show we have a trade deficit because they don't count the investment coming into our economy. And if you look at the 1800s, for example, we had trade deficits most years in the late 1800s because instead of buying our exports, a lot of those dollars were used to invest in our economy, to build the railroads we needed to grow into the 20th century and beyond. So it's important to look beyond the trade deficit. I don't like to use the word trade deficit even, because deficit is such a negative word, and it makes it sound like we're losing and there's something bad. And that's not necessarily the case. It's a trade imbalance. And some people would even argue, look, if we're getting the goods, we're getting more stuff and they're getting the dollars, what would you rather have? Maybe we're better off having the goods than having the dollars. Either way, it's a win-win, mutually beneficial transaction, with some possible exceptions, which I could get into later. So I mentioned the Trump administration. This is how tariffs have changed in percentage terms. The tariff rate has roughly doubled. Now our tariff rate is still pretty low. I'd like to see it back to where it was before President Trump took office. In terms of dollars, the amount we collected in tariff revenue that the government collected doubled as well to about $75 billion. That's a lot of money. Now, compared to the size of the economy, compared to the huge federal budget, it's not a huge amount, not an enormous amount of money. $75 billion for everybody except maybe in Washington, D.C. policymakers, that's a lot of money. And unfortunately, it's not distributed evenly. The tariffs are particularly high, for example, on clothing and shoes. Average tariff rates, 14-15%. These tariffs are what are called regressive taxes, meaning they're especially harmful for lower income Americans. And at the time those tariffs were put into place in 1930, for example, we were trying to protect the jobs of American apparel workers and textile workers. Well, most of those jobs have moved overseas. If there's a reason, if you buy a piece of clothing, it says made in Bangladesh or made in China or made in Colombia. Now that's a little bit misleading, but my point is that the high tariffs on clothing no longer protect jobs. Most of those jobs are gone. So we're paying the high taxes and we're not getting any real job protection benefit. On the flip side, now the reason I said those tags that say "made in Bangladesh" are misleading, is because they're based on the physical value of the cotton and the fabric that goes into the T-shirt. They don't account the American know-how that goes into designing the T-shirts or shoes or whatever clothing you're talking about. They don't count all the marketing. They don't count all the expertise that comes from Americans. Same kind of thing with iPhones. If you buy an iPhone, flip it over on the back, it says made in China, or assembled in China, however, mentions that the know-how came from California. The phone, it's accurate to say, was assembled in China. Does that mean made in China? Well, it's made in China with parts from Taiwan and Japan, the United States, Germany. So it's a little bit misleading to say made in China. That's where the phone comes from, but it has components from all over the world. And I think this is so important to remember when we're talking about, is something made in the USA? Is it made in Canada? That's, I think, an outdated way of thinking about most things. If you look at almost anything you can imagine, whether it's assembled in the United States, assembled somewhere else and imported, they're made with goods and knowledge and know-how and ideas from around the world. So you have a car, it's maybe made in Detroit, made in South Carolina, but the parts are from all over the world. It's made in Mexico, it's got parts from the United States. It's got ideas dreamed up in Japan and Detroit. So I think the countries that are most likely to prosper are the ones that will focus on taking allowing their entrepreneurs to use the best ideas and the best inputs and the best products from around the world, and focusing in those areas that we're especially good at. This is the last slide that I wanted to show. I mean, there's a lot we could talk about. I could go on and on. This is a picture that I told somebody explains the entire or encapsulates the Trump administration's trade policies. He's talking to a group, President Trump is talking to a group of Whirlpool workers. And the reason he's talking to those Whirlpool workers is that he had put tariffs on imported washing machines to benefit Whirlpool. Again, this might be good for Whirlpool workers, at least in the short run, but if you are, if there are many more people who buy washing machines than who make them, so it's bad for the rest of us. But the reason I thought this was so interesting personally is that he's talking to Whirlpool workers, and at this particular presentation, he announced new tariffs on aluminum, and in addition to tariffs on steel. So he's talking to a bunch of Whirlpool workers making appliances that are largely made out of steel and aluminum being harmed by his tariffs. And a big chunk, roughly I think 11% of the washing machines and appliances they make are exported for the most part to Mexico and to Canada. And so that's why on those boxes behind President Trump, there's the American flag and washer, but there's also the Spanish and French language labels on there as well, because to a large extent, many of these are going to be exported to other countries. And it's so disappointing to me when the president is there, instead of saying, I'm going to increase export opportunities, I'm going to cut the cost of steel and aluminum so you can be more competitive, he's talking about throwing up more tariffs on people. We can go through through industry by industry and examples of how tariffs are affecting Americans. And we can talk some about what trade agreements have done and what we should do about foreign trade practices, because there's no doubt that there are times when other countries do impose barriers on U.S. exports, where they subsidize their industries. And those are the kinds of things that I think there's a constructive way to address. But the Trump administration's approach of we're just going to throw up a bunch of tariffs and that's going to change people's actions, I certainly think the evidence shows that that did not work. What it did is it wound up costing the average household hundreds of dollars in higher prices. And really undermining, whether you're a fan of President Trump or not, there were some, in my opinion, good changes with respect to reducing regulations and reducing taxes. But at the same time, he's increasing taxes on imports, increasing regulations affecting imports. And so it really takes away from the economic benefits that he was trying to achieve. And that's a lesson that I hope the Biden administration will learn from, and going forward that we will really return U.S. leadership in the area of doing what's in the best interest of the United States. And America First trade policy really doesn't and shouldn't mean putting tariffs on everything and having decisions made in Washington, D.C. about what you're allowed to buy instead of letting you make those decisions yourself. And so those are the kinds of things that we're going to continue to advocate for here at NTU. Those are some of the things I wanted to mention to open things up to discussion. And I hope it's been helpful.
Brian, that was very, very good. And you started to touch on it near the very end there, because that was like kind of the one thing I was going to ask you to expound on a little bit further. You know, we're kind of assuming everybody's kind of playing from the same playing card. If I'm dealing with Japan, you know, ideally we can have that.
Jeff, can you speak up? Sorry.
I'm sorry. You're right. Sorry about that. I apologize. Let me start over. I'm. They said that was very good, Brian. I appreciate that you were touching at the very end on an issue that I was curious about. And the assumption is everybody's kind of working from the same, you know, playbook, the way Canada, Mexico, we're all sort of trying to be even Steven in what we do. But yet there are other countries like China, whatever, where they can kind of go out of their way because they really have no ends to meet to just undercut everything to the point where it's great for you and me as consumers because, wow, look at how cheap this stuff is. But then we find ourselves in a position where we don't have something vital like what we ran into, not having some components to make medications and stuff, that we lost all of that. So maybe we want to still have a vestige of an industry we've largely lost because it's cheaper to get those shirts made somewhere else. But do we want to have no capabilities in that space or no way to protect ourselves in a down situation?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think in general, I would argue that the way to protect ourselves, let's use the pandemic as an example, and we want to have access to masks and to medicine. Both the Biden and Trump administrations have moved towards trying to impose stricter Buy American requirements to make sure that we make more of those goods here at home. The problem I have with that, if you look at the vaccines we have, for example, they're largely made in many cases by American companies like Pfizer, but with imported, Pfizer's working in conjunction with a German company. A lot of the inputs into the vaccines come from Switzerland. In some cases, the vaccines themselves come from Europe. So I think it's better to have diverse supply sources, so you're not entirely dependent on any one country, including your domestic production. It's one of the maybe a better way to deal with preparing for a future pandemic, for example, would be to have stockpiles of the goods that we know that we might need, and to make sure we have good relationships with our trading partners, so that we're not dependent on any one country. When other countries have pursued policies that we don't like. Up until 1995, what we would try and do often is say, we don't like your subsidies, or we don't like your tariffs, or we don't like your export subsidies, whatever the case may be. So we're going to put tariffs on you until you stop doing it designed as a tool that get other countries to change their trade policies. It turns out that usually didn't work. What happened is the other countries would keep doing what they're doing, and we would keep the tariff. Just one example, in 1963, we were having a trade dispute with Europe over chicken exports. And we wanted Europe to change, so we put a 25% tariff on imported pickup trucks. It was supposed to be a temporary measure targeting imports from Europe. Well, the tariff is still in effect, and it really hits imports from across the world, from Japan, Korea, anybody else, not just European manufacturers. So you have something that was intended to be temporary to encourage another country to change its policy. The other country didn't change its policy and has become more or less a permanent policy, except for those countries we have free trade agreements. By the way, what Ford has done to get around those truck tariffs is they bring in Ford Transit Connects, in case you've seen those driving around, and they bring them in as passenger vehicles. So they've got seats in the back, and they unload them in Baltimore, and they take the seats out of the vehicle, turning it into a truck, because if it comes in as a passenger vehicle, they pay 2.5%. If it was a truck, they pay 25%. The Customs Bureau didn't appreciate that, and there's still some back and forth between the government and Ford about whether they should be allowed to do that. I think we need to look at doing what's in our best interest, and to some extent to lead by example. I do agree that we should support some key industries. When I say key, I mean industries that are important to our national defense, but almost any lobbyist knows that if they want tariffs on sugar, on clothing, they want to restrict the use of foreign ships, they say, well, it's national security. Because of national security, we need to restrict steel imports. We need to restrict aluminum imports. We need to restrict automobile imports. You go down the list, and they use that, in my opinion, more of an excuse than a legitimate reason to promote U.S. interests. So that's maybe a little bit of a roundabout answer to your question.
No, it was good. And it just kind of made me remember, you know, the way you showed they had that workaround on how they could figure out how to get that vehicle in here at a better price point. I, for a while, was dealing with some European cars, and always like a 1.9 liter engine and things of that nature. And it was always like, well, why isn't it like a 2.1? Wouldn't it be better? And they said, oh, yeah, it'd be way better. But at 2.0, there's a new tax bracket applied to that car. So every company makes a 1.9. So they're forced to make a bad decision on the vehicle, but they're trying to beat a tax, you know, level. So it just goes to show how bad it's a thumb on the scale. Let's open it up for some additional questions. Anyone want to raise their hand, please do so. Charles, I see you've got yours cooking.
I do. And thanks, Jeff and Brian. Great presentation. So I mentioned earlier the enforcement arm of some of these agreements, the World Trade Organization, something that's plagued, some clients of mine over the decades, from their kowtowing to big pharma, big agra against the interests of natural health or, safety regarding pesticides and toxins and all kinds of foods. What do we do about that? I mean, I guess an agreement needs an enforcement arm, but if it threatens our access to the kind of health we want, kind of the opposite question that Jeff asked regarding access to health inputs in an emergency. Mine's about the fact that any kind of international government body is necessarily going to be controlled by the powerful, just as domestic government bodies are going to be controlled by the powerful special interests. What do we do about that?
Well, I think the best way to deal with it is to have a policy based on mutual recognition. So let's say we negotiate a free trade agreement with the UK. We say, if something can be sold in the UK, it's been approved by their regulatory bodies, then Americans have the freedom to buy it. If we have something that's been approved by the FDA, by the Consumer Product Safety Commission, then people in the UK have the freedom to buy our product. So we're recognizing that there are different standards, and we're giving Americans the opportunity to decide which products and which standards really meet their best interests, as opposed to saying we're going to harmonize the standards and we're going to get together in a room and have really what I think is the opposite of an agreement that promotes economic freedom, but you have an agreement that reduces economic freedom creating not just international regulations, but regulations that increasingly can be drafted or take effect behind closed doors with less input. So one of the concerns with the USMCA trade agreement, which replaced NAFTA, for example, well, let me back up. We passed NAFTA. It was originally proposed by President Reagan, negotiated by President Bush. President Clinton brought it over the finish line, but he added environmental and labor side agreements, which don't really have anything directly to do with trade, but he wanted to get support from environmental groups and unions. That was his attempt to do it. Well, the USMCA agreement really ramped up the enforcement of some of those environmental and especially the labor provisions by putting a minimum wage floor on automobiles and automobile parts, really designed to make it more expensive to produce in Mexico, and by adding some enforcement mechanisms that they're different than what a free trade agreement would do. I mean, we can argue about whether they're good or bad, but the fear that many said on the libertarian side has said is that these trade agreements, they're fine if they're reducing barriers, but if you're not careful, you're going to have some kind of apparatus, which you just mentioned, which will lead to more barriers. Maybe they're not tariffs, but they're non-tariff barriers. They're economic regulations that make it harder to do business. The last point I'd make is when we have a trade agreement, nobody can ever force us to change our policies in the United States. So if we're found to be in violation of the USMCA agreement, the most that Canada or Mexico could do is respond by putting some tariffs on some of our exports. They can't force us to change our policies. And I think it's important for us to maintain our own sovereignty and allow our trading partners to maintain their own sovereignty too, to do the things that are in their best interests while getting rid of those economic barriers.
Very good. Any other questions there at the moment? Do you have a follow-up, Charles, you'd like to maybe ask?
Sure. For the Trans-Pacific Partnership, again, some of my natural health freedom fans weren't fans with a provision in that proposal to limit countries' labeling requirements for genetically manipulated organisms, GMOs. What about that risk from, you know, what about that risk of special interest exploitation of agreements to, you know, hurt domestic countries' ability to regulate, you know, dangerous products?
Yeah, we really need to be cautious about that. We have the, any trade agreements have an exception saying you are free to do whatever you want for legitimate health and safety reasons. What you can't do is use those regulations as an artificial trade barrier that are designed to help your producers by keeping foreign producers out. But, you know, in many cases, when USMCA was being considered, for example, it was held up mainly due to questions and changes about the patent or the intellectual property timeframe for certain kinds of biological drugs, I should say. So those all come into play as well. The standard has typically been in the United States that we don't like our trade agreements to commit us to make any changes to US laws other than reducing our tariffs. So the reason for that is if we can't get a certain policy, if a group can't get a certain policy enacted through the democratic process in Congress and the executive branch in the courts, they shouldn't be allowed to do an end run and impose those same kinds of restrictions via an international agreement. So making sure that our laws can still be enforced. And trade agreements, one reason they're so long is because they have to define how do we know if an environmental measure is trade restrictive or can be justified by science. If somebody violates the agreement, how do we enforce it? Those kinds of issues. So historically, most of our trade agreements have included a provision that from our Constitution, governments can't expropriate property without providing compensation. That adds a layer of complexity to our trade agreements as well. So it's important, and it's a challenge to make sure that our agreements continue to promote the broad interests of all Americans. And so many people are across the political spectrum are understandably so skeptical of the government that if they start seeing trade agreements being used to bring in a bunch of extraneous provisions unrelated to what maybe should be in a trade agreement, that really undermines the credibility of the agreements and our opportunity to do more going forward. So one of the important things is for groups like those you represent to remain vigilant and remain engaged. Fortunately, under US law, all these trade agreements that are negotiated, there's a period for public review, and there's a defined process for Congress to consider them before they take effect. And everybody needs to be prepared to take advantage of that opportunity.
Brian, I was going to ask you one quick question in that, you know, we see, you know, what we're describing here in trade and so on, but a part of all of what goes on is kind of hidden, and that's between people that work here and work here and then people that come and work here, you know, for outside contracting reasons. But then there's all the people that are here that are sort of like beneath the surface you know, how does that interrupt the idea of having all these agreements and activities when that's sort of undercutting any of that stuff because they don't really match either side of the equation? They're just like almost like a drain on everything as a part of being factored into the overall plan.
Well, one of the challenges with respect to immigration, for example, why do people come here? Because they have a better opportunity than they have at home. And so our trade agreements create opportunities for people to have better jobs at home. You look at Mexico, for example, people don't remember, but before NAFTA, there were concerns that Mexico was going to go the way of Cuba. And we viewed NAFTA as a way to ensure that that didn't happen, not just for the interests of the people in Mexico, but in our interest to have a strong and reliable neighbor and trading partner on our southern border. So those issues are really interrelated. You know, another thing that happens in trade policy is politicians find it easy to blame our foreign trading partners a lot of times for problems that are created here at home and specifically in Washington, D.C. And we need to be careful not to scapegoat foreigners for problems that we've created. If we make it hard to do business, if we raise taxes and impose barriers and things go downhill, let's make sure we understand what is causing those problems. For example, we have huge federal debt, huge budget deficits. Well, how do we finance the budget deficits? The federal government borrows. It borrows from Americans, but it borrows from people in other countries as well. Every dollar that a foreign investors sends to us to finance our budget deficit is a dollar that is not available to buy a U.S. export. So if a politician is going to run around and say, oh, we have this big trade deficit, they're ripping us off. Well, maybe the reason there's a trade deficit is because we're so much in debt and we're using those foreign dollars to finance our excessive spending instead of letting those dollars being used to buy exports. So it's important, I think, not to let U.S. politicians off the hook for problems that they've created, everything's the part of China, everything's the fault of China, and that allows us to focus on those very real problems that do exist, and nobody would deny that.
Very good, Charles. I think I saw your hand pop up.
So let's get ideal libertarian. So many want to replace the income tax with the sales tax, and then there's arguments over exemptions for a sales tax. You know, it's regressive on basic food items. Well, what if we exempt sales, income, and property from taxation and just tax imports and have that domestic free trade zone you said the founders wanted, and then, you know, carry forth with either trade agreements or just unilateral repeal of any barriers to entry that we impose on foreigners. What about that ideal scenario?
Well, it's not a new idea. That's how we financed most of the federal government through the 1800s. And if you remember that chart I showed that demonstrated U.S. and foreign tariffs, one reason foreign tariffs have been high is not because they're protectionists trying to protect their industries, is because that's how developing countries were able to raise money for the government. That was their main finance source. So so high tariffs in the U.S. in the 1800s, some of it was protectionist in nature, and we had big debates between the North and South specifically over those tariffs. And one of the key phrases among free traders at the time was tariffs for revenue only, meaning we should only use tariffs to fund the government, not to pick and choose winners based on who's got the most political influence and which region has the most political influence. So we switched from that to the income tax. And what that did, Charles, is as well, we all know what happened. Taxes skyrocketed, and the size of the federal government skyrocketed. And if we were to tomorrow fund everything based on tariffs, You can say this is a good idea. You can say it's a bad idea, whatever your view may be. The federal government would have to shrink by about 90%. I'm pulling that number out of a hat, but we don't import enough. There's not a tariff rate high enough to fund government activities at the current level. So if we switch to that, we would either have to make some radical changes to federal and state spending. Maybe that'd be a good thing. Or we'd have to come up with other revenue sources to keep spending going. But the idea that, we can just increase tariffs and use that to pay for all this government spending that I hear expressed sometimes, that just wouldn't raise enough money. Again, if we doubled tariffs, that would get us to about $150 billion a year. If you double it again, that would be about $300 billion a year. And that just doesn't make a dent in how much the federal government spends. I don't want to come across as saying the government spends its money wisely and that I don't want to see any reductions in the size of the federal government, not at all. But it would certainly be a radical cut if we were to rely on tariffs. I think if we had a more of a consumption tax type of system, sales taxes or changes in the way the income tax works, that would be compatible with treating imported goods and domestically made goods the same in a way that maybe a better tax system.
Question for you on that, and I'm going to slip this last one in here because we're running out of time, so you'll have to give me a quick answer on this. But taking what you were describing to its natural conclusion, because, you know, Charles is proposing the perfect solution, obviously, but if we keep going like we've been going, because there seems to be no one counting any pennies anymore, what's the conclusion? Where are we going to end up? I mean, you're kind of sitting out there watching all this. If we don't stop what our profligate ways, when and what are we going to have happen?
Well, I hate to predict the future, but I'm an optimistic person, and it's kind of tough to be optimistic given the last year or so. But in many cases, our country's faced challenges, and we've pulled through. My hope is that Americans are still wise enough to have a level of responsibility that will allow the government to do what it needs to do, you know, without people joke about bankrupting us. But we've learned, I think, in the last year that things that we thought never could happen in the United States, well, they can happen in the United States. And I hope we're able as a result of that to be wiser going forward. It's particularly, everything is off the rails because of the pandemic, and we're going to spend money here and spend money there. Some of it probably in good ways, a lot of it in ways that probably shouldn't be done. But hopefully once we get past that, we'll have some more fiscal sanity. But I say I'm optimistic, but if you look at what the Republican and Democrat parties have done, you might say, Brian, you're crazy. But I guess we'll just have to see.
Well, part of it is I see now they started calling it the Uniparty. So maybe that's a part of this process where people begin to realize what's afoot. So that could be a good sign. Brian, I want to thank you so much for being here today.
Hey, thank you. I really enjoyed it. And you have my intu.org website and Free Trade Brian on Twitter for anybody who has some follow-up questions or would like to know more. Happy to engage and really appreciate you guys having me on.